welcome to modeling meaning and knowledge. And as usual, I will give a short tutorial introductory talk. And today's topic is an intellectual obituary of Melissa Bauermann, the scholar who left us in year 2011. And the reason why I want to say some words about her is that if I don't actually appreciate Chomsky as linguist as much as many others, even though in Finland we have had, many have been having critical views on Chomsky already for a long time. Whereas I would really like to appreciate a scholar like Melissa Bauermann, who I learned to know a little bit more than 10 years ago in one symposium in Lund University, organized by Peter Järdefors. And I learned to know her as a scholar who is very serious about linguistic understanding, kind of going, studying a large number of languages, not only kind of by books, but really going into field work, studying kind of the languages and their place. And her work is very interdisciplinary, not only linguistics, but psychological, philosophical aspects, touching upon theoretical aspects, but as said, very much empirical work, traveling around the world, including Finland. I understood that she has also had spent time, long time in Finland to study Finnish and to understand the Finnish language and its intricacies. And that leads us to the question of translation, because someone like her, who has familiarized herself with dozens of different languages and their properties, brings us to the question of how can we translate and understand multiple languages so that we transfer our knowledge of the world from one language, using one language and then another, trying to convey the meaning. And the languages have, of course, different syntactic properties, but here actually I will talk shortly about some conceptually oriented issues. And here I directly use Melissa Bauermann's slides actually from that symposium about 10 years ago. So the two case studies that she addresses are based on this basic idea of grounding of meaning in cognition and our experience of the world, external world. Embodiment is one of the key phrases used, so that the language, whatever we are doing, is kind of grounded in our existence in the world and our action in the world. And here the metaphors we live by is one famous book, and another book by George Lakoff is this Women, Fire and Dangerous Things, which is famous in this field, where he discusses these issues in depth. And in Bauermann's examples, the first one is related to the fact that different languages divide this conceptual space in different ways. And here she used the example of Korean and English and how the different expressions related to in English putting on would be the same whether you put on gloves here or your shoes or whatever. So it's the whole body which has the same kind of status. But in Korean they were depending on the place of the body, so the putting on would be having three different linguistic appearances. And here the Joy Bauermann 1991 is a classical article related to this kind of studies. And then there are different languages divide again here, for example, Japanese is another example, and then there are other languages from Africa, which then have different kinds of logics related to how they divide the conceptual space in this case, related to the bodily distinctions. And other example, the second example that she used was related to carrying here in English, so that in different contexts, carrying is the same thing, so very many kinds of different types of carrying. But if you would take, for example, some Indian language, Navajo language here, so there would be a different word for different contexts of carrying, different types of carrying, and then the distinctions or the divisions are different again for another language in that area. And that means that that of course constitutes also a certain kind of ambiguity for translation at the conceptual level. And in this case the categories are quite distinct, but of course we can consider also that in some cases there are continua where the kind of drawing the line between, let's say, green and blue, and where does it turn into green, does turn into blue, and how do different languages, for example, consider these distinctions. So that's a more fine-grained problem related to translation. So different cultures and different populations around the world have kind of decided to devise their understanding of the world in different ways and build different category systems. And Quine, for example, as a philosopher, even stated that translation is impossible because these different divisions or these differences are such that that leads into a situation that translation is really impossible. But we don't need to be that pessimistic. So the kind of question is that how do we facilitate understanding in the case that, for example, we may need additional kind of description of the contextual factors when they are considered in different languages. This is one attempt, 2008, where we were having a kind of experimental work where we created a kind of conceptual map of the underlying phenomenon, and then we projected German and English words on this kind of mapping. And this is kind of idea that we don't need to only ground our description of the world in the words that we have at the hand, and especially not only one individual words, but of course we can always refine the description with more detailed phrases, and also to consider that how could we, for example, consider the discrepancies that may exist between different languages in the way of describing the world. And for that purpose, there are of course many many kind of works related to these issues, but I have very much enjoyed having had this book around, Means of Translation by Professor Andrew Chesterman, who happened to come here, just this was not an organized on purpose, but that when he discusses, for example, translation strategies, so I have found it very useful. Thank you for your attention.